This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Hey, everybody. How are you? Yes, it is. Let me turn the music down. It is The Ramble. I'm Alex Bennett. We go on until midnight tonight with our little gathering here. In about a half hour from right now, we get on with our citizen panel. But right now, we got a guest to go to because we always have a guest every night to talk to. Okay, everybody. Quiet on the set.
Quiet on the set.
No, I said quiet on the set.
Quiet on the set.
No, don't yell quiet on the set when I say quiet on the set, because we want it to be quiet on the set.
Oh, okay, you're right. I'm sorry. I apologize. Quiet on the set, everybody.
Oh, God.
Go ahead.
There must be Bob Rubin. Hello, Bob.
Lighten up, everybody. The old Rube's here.
Yes, the old Rube is back with us. And
how are you?
Let me see here. As I've said before, I'm still not at room temperature, so I guess I'm okay.
That's good, man.
Yeah, yeah.
You haven't even started to crystallize or anything yet. You're fine.
No, I'm pretty much just...
That means you're 100% pure.
100% pure?
Yeah, as if you start to crystallize, that means you're not 100% pure.
Oh, I see. Okay. Well, anyway, Bob...
Maybe it's the other way around.
Before we get going, we really should plug this. Who knows? You may have reached your 8,500 by the time this is broadcast. But,
oh, that's true.
But we should tell people that you're trying to raise money for beer. No, you're trying to raise money.
I'm trying to raise beer money. Hey, that's my next crowdfunding campaign.
Yeah, right. I need $20,000 for beer.
I was going to, I seriously was going to launch a campaign a couple of years ago, simply called "I Need $6 to Make It to My Front Door."
Anyway, so Bob has had a crowdfunding thing going. Things, can we say this, have not been going that great, right?
No, it's good now, though. It's good.
Because Bob is now at, what, 57?
50, yeah, almost 57.
Well, it'd be 50. Okay, when's your birthday?
My birthday is, we already had it.
Oh, okay, yeah, because when this is broadcast.
Right, when this is broadcast, I will have been turning 57 years old. Mm-hmm. And that's exciting, man. It's exciting.
Is it exciting? Well, anyway, he's 57, and he's in a business where they go, "Oh, you're too old."
Oh, they started doing that 10 years ago.
Really?
But I say, fuck you. Don't tell me I'm too this or too that. I'm going to do what I do, and that's what the crowdfunding campaign's all about.
Yeah, well, I mean, so he's had to go out essentially begging, right?
Yeah.
This is a new form of being a mendicant. Isn't that a wonderful word?
What does it mean?
It means beggar, mendicant. Oh. Yeah. This is a new form of being a mendicant. You get a crowdfunding thing going, you know. And you go, hey, give me some money so I can, you know, do this or that, you know.
Then I'm trying to raise money to film my own comedy special and then get it straight on Netflix.
Well, if Netflix takes it, but there are a lot of other places to go with it.
Oh, yeah, there's plenty of places to go. But the thing is, everybody, all the big comedians are on Netflix now. They've been luring them away from HBO, you know? But besides the giant ones, everybody and their brother seems to have a comedy special on Netflix right now.
And some of them are not that good. I mean,
no, but I figure the timing's right because this is what they're into. Yeah. And, if I get on Netflix, I'm not going to get as big a deal as, you know, Dave Chappelle. But the point is, I'm trying to build an audience again. So getting on Netflix, a lot of people will see what I do.
But you could also go over to Hulu. There are a lot of other options.
Oh, yeah, there's Hulu. There's Access TV. There's Amazon Prime. Now, YouTube has a new thing called YouTube Red, where it's You sign up for it, and they're already doing original movies.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, so, you know, all I'm saying is there are a lot of places you can shop this around.
Absolutely.
You could also shop at the HBO, Showtime, you know.
That's all, true, all yeah. Those people, and, so. And see, no one, I just woke up one day and said, you got to be, well, first of all, you have to be delusional to be in this business, number one.
Yeah.
And you have to be delusional to be at it as long as I have been, man, and just go, hey, everything's great. Another cocktail, please. But, you know, I told you that old line about Hollywood, but getting pulled over by the Hollywood police, put down your hopes and step away from your dream. And, what were we talking about?
So the crowdfunding? Anyway, so anyway, we were talking about your crowdfunding. So it's kind of a new form of begging, but it's usually to better effect, let's say.
You know,
because you're also offering the audience something back, like, you know, for X number of dollars, you'll put them down as a producer.
Right, right. Instance. And also, you know, you just give them something like a...
so far,
like
because...
You're going to get a show poster, and you get your name in the credits, and you get free tickets to the show if you want to come out.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the stuff we have, free tickets, posters, and... getting your name in the credit roll, and then we have executive producerships and producerships.
What happens at $500? Do I get the gift bag? Do I get the tote bag?
At $500, you get a big hug from me, but you gotta find me.
I know that one of our listeners to this program donated $500, which made me look like a piker because I could only afford $100. I am not working right now. And
everything. That was a generous donation, and I just want to say, can I say her name?
Sure.
I just want to say a big, big, heartfelt thank you to Renee Collins, and I really appreciate your donation.
Yeah.
And I was trying to figure out, gee whiz, who's Renee Collins? And then Alex told me that she's a listener, and thank you so much.
Well, I don't know how much I helped, but I've constantly had you at the top of my Facebook page.
Oh, telling
people to send you money. So I don't know how much of that money that was raised were from my efforts, but
I'm sure there's a lot of it because there are a lot of names that I don't recognize, you know. And the thing about crowdfunding campaigns is that most of the money comes from family and friends.
Yeah, well, you know, the largest donation you had came from one of the nicest guys that I've known in my career. And that's Patton Oswalt.
Patton Oswalt, he came through big time, and he put, this is how powerful his social media is. He put a big, big blast on Facebook.
Yeah.
Said all these kind things about me. And it just, you know, he's such a nice guy. It's rare to see another comedian stand up for another comedian to this point, you know.
And Patton has always been, you know, I would love to know how to get a hold of Patton because I can't. I have no way of getting a hold of him because once you lose contact with somebody for even a couple of years in this business, finding out how you can write to them or whatever, their email address doesn't remain the same. The only email that has remained the same over the last 20 years or so of somebody I know is Penn Jillette. He still has the same email address, but...
Well, I change my email address every 3 years as I get more famous every 3 years.
So if you ever talk to Pat and tell him to get in touch with me, because I'd love to have him on the show.
I'll do that.
And I know Patton has always said very nice things about me, to me and other people. So I would love to have him on. But, so he donated a huge, a really substantial amount. Okay.
Yeah, he did. And not only did he donate a substantial amount, but what he did was, he put a very sterling endorsement on Facebook with all these kind words and just incredible. And it's just like, oh, made me feel good just reading it.
Mm-hmm.
So
maybe I helped, and I'm sure his endorsement certainly helped. And, you know, and you don't, this with his GoFundMe, you don't have to make it by a certain time. Otherwise, you don't get it, right?
Right, right.
That's why I gave my little $100, because I figured you wouldn't get it, and then I wouldn't have to pay it. You know, but this one.
Boy, you're doomed.
I'm playing the ultimate cheap Jew card. Anyway, no. But this one, you actually, even if you don't reach that goal, you do get the money that's there.
Right.
Yeah, which is much better than the other one where, what's the other one?
Kickstarter,
where if you say you want $8,500 and within a month you don't get $8,500 and you don't get anything.
Well, here's what's good about it. I can sit in a bar and drink all day and still make money. Yeah. No, here's what's good about it. I told you the camera package, for instance. These are top of the line, $15,000 cameras. We're using three of them. It's already high def broadcast quality, and the camera, sound, and crew package is $5,500, which by the time this airs, we will have made. So I can go ahead and pay for the for that, and that means it's done. We're doing the show, which is great. Then I keep the campaign running, and even if I haven't raised the post-production money, by the time I shoot the show, I can still run it for another month, you know, till we get our goal. And so that's what's good about being able to use the money as you go along. With Kickstarter, not only can you not use the money as you go along, but if you don't reach your goal, it all goes back to the people, you know.
Yeah.
Which is fair. I understand that. But, you know, like I said, just the fact that some... You know, like I said, I'm able to pay for the cameras now, which is great. You know, and then I'll worry about post-production money as the weeks go by. You know, but I think we're going to reach our goal. Well, our goal is $8,500. And
you didn't come to me about the cameras because I have at least two GoPros. So,
oh no, man, I could have saved a bundle.
Yeah,
I really could have gone drinking every day.
Right.
Ah.
And we could have put one on a drone and just hovered it over the audience and, you know.
No, because I'd want to be the one controlling the drone. They're just so fun to play with.
Yeah.
Well, then it gets in the way of your performance when you're...
But anyway, if people haven't given money to this poor slob, you know, you simply go to GoFundMe and just put in Bob Rubin, right? And
that'll
get them there. Or you can go to my Facebook page, and somewhere I will be constantly flogging this thing, too.
I appreciate that, Alex. That helps a lot.
You know, that will lead you to it. And it also leads you to a video of him. I just think you're one of those guys who really needed that push by somebody. And Roseanne was very good at trying to give you a push at one point.
Yeah, yeah.
But then she wasn't very good at giving herself a push. So, you know.
Right. yeah, she kind of destroyed a lot of things on her own. Like when we did that Saturday Night Special.
That was a show that she executive produced, right? And that was
she was the executive producer, but she was very difficult to work with. I mean, not with me. We got along fine. I mean, she made herself a difficult person to work with between her and the Fox executives.
Yeah, and it was supposed to be a competitor to Saturday Night Live, right? They had the Mad TV show.
Right. What they were going to do was they wanted to run Mad TV, which was an hour. They wanted to run that with our show back to back, so we cover a 2-hour slot, which goes against the 90-minute slot for Saturday Night Live. And talk about coming this close, boy, you know. But I saw the handwriting on the wall, as they say, when we started it, because first it was supposed to be a year, and then suddenly it got cut to 13 weeks, and I'm like, what's going on? And then they dumped us after 6 weeks, you know.
Yeah. And it was probably because she was difficult at that time to work with, right?
Yeah.
Because if she wasn't difficult to work with, they probably would have seen it through a lot longer.
That's what I'm guessing, you know. So it's kind of weird. It was a big break, but yet it was taken away almost right after I got it, you know. And you know, and I had to do three auditions for that show, you know, to get on the show. Yeah, and the last audition was in a room full of studio executives. I mean, everybody in a suit, which you talk about a tough crowd. But I did all these crazy characters, including just being my good old self. And then I found out later from another producer that they thought I was crazy. And they did. They thought I was crazy. And they go, we can't hire him as a cast member. We think maybe he'd make a brilliant writer if you could control him a little bit. But we can't have a loose cannon like that on the cast. And then Roseanne said, no Ruben, no show.
Really?
Yeah. So it's a classic double-edged sword. On one hand, she put her foot down to make sure I was a cast member. But then she put her other foot down on all the studio executives, and they're like, we don't need this shit, man.
Well, you know, the thing is, that's the trouble with studio executives. They didn't get you.
No, they did. No, it's always been the, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you've been a hard sell because I once said to somebody, what's the hardest thing to sell? And they said to me, something that's never been done before.
Yeah.
Because if it's been done before, oh, yeah, I know it. They feel comfortable with it. But if it's something completely different, they don't feel comfortable with that. They're not going to put their careers on the line for something different.
And so they're not, man. And that's when you get smacked in the face with the word business. You know, like they always say, well, it's show business, you know. And then when you realize, oh, my God, it is. Because these cats, they look at anything that's slightly different. They look at it as, well, that's me putting my neck out on the line, and I'm not going to lose this cush job that I have.
Exactly.
So if you look around the corner and see what your neighbor's doing, just do something derivative of your neighbor. And
that's the answer, by the way, to why television doesn't come up with much original stuff.
Absolutely.
The original stuff is the stuff that sneaks under the door and manages to get on the air and then becomes a success because people liked it.
Right.
You know? But otherwise, I mean, Seinfeld was a good example of that. Nobody believed in Seinfeld.
Well, the story was one guy at the network, NBC, stuck his neck out. And because when Seinfeld premiered, it was running real low.
Yeah, it was
even though it was a great show, but when it premiered, people hadn't caught on to it.
Well, it was the late Brandon Tartikoff that saved that show. It said,
was that
no,
who it was?
Yeah, we're not taking it off. That thing just needs the right time slot. They did 6 episodes. Then the next year, they did another 6 episodes. And then they moved it to, I think it was Thursday night, when Cheers quit. And the rest is history, you know. But yeah, the fact is,
you know,
they don't get something that's never been done before.
Well, you know, that's a rare moment, you know, for an executive to say, no, this show stays on the air. That's what you don't have going on in Hollywood. And that was one of the last rare moments, because I don't even think you have one of those moments right now. And
there are a few shows on TV, and you wonder how they got there. I mean, This Is Us is a very good show, and it's on the air. And in its third season is a show called American Crime, which I just latched onto this year. I watch it and I go, number one, how did this thing ever get on a network? And secondly, how did it last 3 years? I mean, it's that good a show. So occasionally somebody gets an attack of good taste, you know, but the rest is just imitation. I can't remember who it was that said, Harlan Ellison, science fiction writer. I heard an interview with him. And he said, the trouble with television is if television were art and the Mona Lisa got painted and was a hit, everybody would start painting Mona Lisas.
It's true, man.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah, you know, it's very hard. And I've been hit in the head with a shovel so many times down here that you would wonder how I keep going. But I love doing stand-up, so that's how it's going to be to the end of my life. But the reason, you know, I know it's like you don't get people taking a chance with something different. You know, it just doesn't happen anymore. It was closer to that happening, you know, when I first moved down here, or actually when I started doing stand-up, that was the beginning of when things actually started to change, and the infrastructure got stronger and stronger and stronger.
Yeah.
To now they're like, well, we don't even need actors or writers. We're just doing reality shows. But the other thing is I moved here because the people were very warm and sincere. So I always get a pickup every day just by saying, howdy, neighbor.
Yeah, well, you know, Hollywood is that place in the sun where it has often been said that if you can't be sincere, fake it.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Yeah, boy, this is a good old fake and bake right
here.
You
know, the last time we talked, we were on the discussion of high points in your life, and somehow we've gone into so many different directions today, we never got back to that topic. But I'm starting to think...
I just want to say another one thing real quick I forgot is there was a chimpanzee running one of the studios now, and just show you what a tough town is. I had a meeting with the chimpanzee. He didn't give me any eye contact. Can you believe that?
Really?
Yeah.
It's
a rough town.
They always look out the window or whatever. But anyway, what I was going to say is that we were talking about high points in your life, and I guess we can continue this next time. But that there are various high points. We've talked about birth being the first big event.
Oh, yeah.
The second big event would have to be, for you and I, bar mitzvah. But that doesn't necessarily set with other people, so they have to go immediately to becoming 21.
Wait a minute. What about getting your driver's license, 16?
Oh, yeah, getting your driver's license. And I just thought of another one. The first time you got laid.
Right, right.
Okay.
Non-cash deal.
You never forget the first time you got laid. And I always often loved how people would say to me, so how was it the first time you got laid? And I have to say, I don't know. I had nothing else to compare it to. It was the best I had ever had.
Yeah.
You know, but in retrospect, I can't really tell you whether it was good or bad. It was just doing it that was the event.
Well, I know it gets better because I, for instance, just as, maybe 12 years ago, I stopped having to hold a manual in my hand, which is nice. It frees up both hands.
Yeah, it's good. 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 So there were a couple of other events in there. And then after 21, what's the next big event? I guess getting married, if you haven't been married before you were 21.
Yeah, getting married's a big event. Big birthdays are... They say big birthday is 30, but I don't really remember being that big because 30 is no different from being a teenager.
The next really big birthday that you get is probably 50. You know, I mean, when you actually delineate that something has happened now and you're passing over to another portion of your life, you know, you don't really go, oh, damn, I'm 35, middle age. Oh, what a milestone. You don't do that.
Yeah.
You know?
You don't even do that at 40, man. When I turned 40, I had a classic freak out, man. When I was 41, I started getting booming heart palpitations, you know, it was just a classic, you know, middle-aged panic.
It was a panic attack.
Yeah, and then, but the funny thing was, another time I was getting chest pain, and I went to the clinic to see a doctor, and it was this young woman, and they took an EKG, and it was abnormal. She's saying, there's something wrong with your left ventricle, because the top part of your heart's not communicating with the bottom part of your heart. And I just looked at her and I said, don't badmouth my left ventricle. It's been with me since day one. My central ventricle, my right ventricle, they skip town. You can badmouth them, but don't badmouth my left ventricle. She blinked her eyes twice and said, your left ventricle isn't working. The top part of your heart isn't communicating with the bottom of your heart. And then she says to me, she goes, you're going to need an echocardiogram, but we got to see if your insurance is going to cover it. Do you want to wait here or do you want to come back? I said, no, I'll wait here, of course. So then about an hour later, I'm sitting in the waiting room and a guy opens the door and he goes, come here. and he goes, sit down. And he has a piece of paper, and he goes, he starts to talk. And I go, I know. I need to get an echocardiogram, but you're not sure if my insurance is going to pay for it. And he just looked at me and said, no. Says here, you've been recommended for psychiatric evaluation.
And with that, Bob, we have to bring it to a close again.
Oh, okay.
So we'll have to continue this high moments in life next time.
Okay, that'd be good.
Yeah. In the meantime, people, give money to Bob's little personal charity there at GoFundMe.
I'm not just asking, I'm begging.
He's begging. So, you know, and you don't get that often from a comic. Well,
but here's here's the good news. It took me 34 years to finally tape my first stand-up special, but here's the good news. I am now going to tape a stand-up special once every 34 years.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Roop.
This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. That's Bob Rubin, ladies and gentlemen. And, well, let's get him off the screen here, okay? Let's get that on the screen. And if I do this, I'll get me on the screen. There we are. You know what we're doing? You know what we've been doing all along for the last, couple of weeks now. So we've been running the show on Facebook. And that's been a real good deal for us because a lot of people are getting to know the show and to find me again, old fans, people like that. And so I have been putting it on Facebook, but I've only been putting basically the audio and then a picture of me like this talking to the people. But I've never put the people on except on Fridays when we do our Friday night ramble and we do it with video. Well, I started doing it on the machine that has everything else on it and so on. And so tonight, I can actually let you see the citizen panel. I mean, I could sit here and not show the citizen panel, but there's every reason to show the citizen panel, okay? And, we could sure stand to get a call from you. And what you do, let me just get a few things taken care of here. I want to just clean this up so that I can see everything just fine. I should have done this earlier, but, you know, anyway. You can call us using Skype, S-K-Y-P-E. You go to Skype.com, download the program, and then you just call us using Skype. Our ID is GabNet Live. In other words, if you want to call us on Skype, we're GabNet Live. That's it, G-A-B-N-E-T-L-I-V-E. And also, besides being GabNet Live, you can call us on the telephone. If you don't want to go through the whole problems that entail with using Skype, although there are not very many of them, 347-352-0079 is the number. You'd think I could put it on the screen, right? And but I haven't done it yet. So maybe we'll make a lower third or something down here that'll do that for us. Anyway, I'm sitting here waiting for people to call. And I don't see anybody's even coming online. So who knows? This may be, we've had nothing but completely filled up nights with people. We've had what we call full houses. That means that there's more than, there's about nine people plus me is a full house. And we've been getting those over and over repeatedly. But maybe we won't get it tonight. Like Phil isn't going to call tonight because Phil's got something to do. And that's fine with me. We'll just get on with the show. But you've got to prove him wrong that he's so valuable that he's got to call. You've got to call us. And I the lines are now open. And I sit here thinking about what am I going to talk about? I have something to talk about, actually. But see, if I start talking about stuff, well, here we go. This is one of our new people, by the way. Anthony Zamboro. Hello, Anthony.
Good. How are you?
How are you doing?
I'm all right. And
have you got some?
Yeah, I had to mute your other feed there.
Okay, good. I thought that might have been me. You know, and God forbid no. It should be me. Let me. All we've got is really a photograph on you, but let me show people the photograph so they can see what a Well, that's not the right thing. Let me push this. Okay. Come on, damn you. Okay. There we go. There we go. There we go. There's Anthony Zem. Zambataro. Anthony called us the other night on a show that none of you knew we were doing. And it was a Sunday night program that I just did on the, to be doing it, right? And it was a good show. And Anthony called for the first time. And so we had this brand new talent with us.
Wouldn't go that far.
Well,
but it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun.
Yes, it was. Wait a minute. Did I just screw something up terribly here? Hold on a second. Let me see here.
Let me turn my camera. I'm in a dark room, but I can still turn my camera on here.
Yeah. I'm still trying to get used to all this these different things. Oh, you are in a dark room. Oh, there you go. But you're dark.
Well, yeah.
Did you pay?
Hence the name. I mean, it is a Sicilian thing.
Did you pay the light bill?
I did pay the light bill.
Huh?
I could try to get closer to the light, but it's usually where I sit.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Here comes Scott Boddicker. Scott is from Plano, Texas. Have you ever heard of Plano, Anthony?
I've heard of it. I've never been there. I do my best to stay out of Texas. I don't want to.
I don't blame you.
I think the best way to describe Plano, Texas is it's not the middle of nowhere, but you can see the middle of nowhere from there.
There are more people in Plano, Texas.
Yeah.
Than on the Big Island where Renee lives.
Really?
Yes.
Son of a bitch. Give me a little video there, Scott, so we can see you.
Oh, it's on, I thought.
Well, not here.
It says it's on here, so
there you go. You just right, kicked it in.
Cycle
yeah,
it.
There we go. Now we
Where's
got you.
Where's Anthony from?
Well, Anthony is from the Bay Area, right?
Oh, okay.
Where exactly, Anthony, was that again?
San Jose, California.
San Jose, California. Here's an unknown phone number calling us. Let's see here. Let's see who this is. This could be a surprise. Who is this? Hello?
Brian.
Are you there?
Oh, wait. I screwed something up. Am I here?
Oh, is that Steve?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why I screwed up. I'm getting used to this. I'm on a brand new Android phone, and it's really cool.
Well, that's wonderful. It's not so cool that you can we can see you because we can't see you because you're on a phone.
I know.
If I was using the latest Skype, we would be able to see you. Okay, but they are so stubborn with the way they're running that thing. I have rolled back to an old system of theirs so that I can run it okay. So anyway,
yeah.
How was your leg, right?
Yeah, it's actually going really, really well. I do have a surgery coming up on don't worry, it's not gory. It's good. It's coming up Thursday. And I think like a couple days after that, I should be out of the hospital and back home.
How long have you been in the hospital?
Like 2.5 weeks almost now.
Oh, God, you must be getting squirrely. Because I was in for 4.5 days, and by the way, they kept pumping painkillers into me, so I was in La La Land for most of it. But I still hated being there for 4.5 days.
Well, I'm getting pumped with heavy antibiotics. I'm on oxicillin.
Yeah, but that doesn't get you high. That's no fun. Tell them you're in great pain.
But you know what, though? It's making my life. It's eradicating this infection. It's great.
Here's what we did, what I did. When you're in the hospital, have you ever spent any real time, either of you other guys, Anthony or Scott, hospital?
Oh, yeah.
So you know what I'm about to tell you. Were you in pain?
Yeah.
You were in pain. Okay, yeah. that's as far as we got to go now. When you're in pain, they say, on a scale of 1 to 10, what's your pain?
Yeah,
now, if they're 10. If they're giving you like morphine, and you say
anything
less than 9, you're an idiot. Okay, because whatever number they give you, that's how strong they pump you full of the painkillers. So
yep, always say 10.
Always say, hey, oh man, it's a 10. If I had a 9, I'd be in great pain. Hello, Jeff Stein.
How are you?
He's joining us. Jeff, turn on your camera so everybody can see that. What I consider one of the world's great beards. Okay. Well, I'm not talking about somebody who's, you know, dating a gay guy, you know. Oh, and hey, Kevin's calling. Boy, we're getting there. We're getting there. Hello, Kevin.
Good evening.
How are you? Turn on your camera so we can see the other great beard in America.
I'm getting there.
Yeah.
So let me ask you, did you ever get one of those the morphine pumps where you actually self-administer?
No, but my wife did.
Yeah, I got one of those.
Give me some. Oh, I think I'll take more. No, that doesn't work exactly.
I know. They came over and told me that after they looked at the chart of it.
Who's just joined us? Is this
this is Tim.
That's what I thought. Yeah. Tim, you know what I'm going to do with you, Tim? Hold on a second. I'm going to actually go rename Tim's thing so it isn't the phone number, so it says Tim, so that every time you call I know it's Tim.
I'm named after Alan Ladd, actually.
Your
middle name is Alan.
How are you named? Your middle name
is the Alanway.
Oh, I see. Okay, well, anyway, there's Tim, and we have Jeff, and we have Anthony, and we have Kevin, and we have wait a minute. I guess I better do the same thing with Steve. Yeah. Hold on a second. Hey. Rename Steve. Well, yeah.
You know what? Let me call you right back because I realized I wanted to shut my call waiting off, and what I did instead was that's why you didn't know when I called. Instead of star 70 to shut it off, I did 67. That's private. Let me call right back.
Oh, okay. Call right back.
All right.
If you want to, hold on a second. Folks, I screwed up here. Hold on. There, I got to do that. All right. Okay. So we lost Steve for a moment. And when we get him back, I can. But anyway, so what I'm saying is when you get morphine, you know, you never tell them you've got like a 3, you know. You go, no, I haven't got a 3. I've got, it's excruciating. And they'll get rid of you, you know. They'll put you, they give you the best stuff they can. Hold on a second. Let me.
Spicer said his pain was a 10 today.
Who? A Spicer. Now wait a minute.
Spicer.
Now you see again. Here we go. Steve is calling, and he's got his name there. Hello, Steve. You're back again.
Yeah, I'm here.
You can hear us. We can't hear you though.
Okay, now I'm good.
Yeah, now
good.
Now you're
all
good.
Right.
Let me ask a question about Spicer. Okay. By the way, I'm about ready.
That's
I'm about,
what I wanted to talk about.
I'm about ready to start breaking my rule, which was don't watch the news because, I just feel dumb now, you know, when I do this show. Somebody says, "Did you hear what Spicer did today?" No. You know, now on one hand,
you may feel dumber after listening to Spicer.
Well, that's the other problem. The other day, for a brief moment, I decided I would watch Trump when they were swearing in Gorsuch, right? And he started speaking, and after about 30 seconds, I had to turn it off because I just can't stand Trump. He's stupid.
Yeah, I know.
You know, and I just can't stand him.
Almost as the spokesperson, Mr. Spicer, who stuck his butt in his mouth today.
Well, now, that's what I want to know about.
Jeez, what an asshat.
No chemical warfare in World War II.
In his great effort to tell us how bad Assad was, he said that that not even Hitler used chemical weapons against his own.
I
couldn't believe that. I mean, I'll shut up, but I've got to say, this is why I called. I called because this Spicer guy, whatever. Every day I think I've heard it all, and the next day it's worse and worse. And I couldn't believe when I, it's like, how stupid is this going to get?
Well, so he said that. What I love about that is, I mean, I didn't hear the comment. I wonder. All I saw was a thing that came over my phone that said Spicer has walked back his statements about Hitler. And I went, what the fuck could he say about Hitler? You know, he wasn't going to compare Trump to Hitler. You know, and so to hear this is obviously a man who doesn't even have a grasp of history. Okay,
I know.
And some of the film that I saw him backing out of it, he looked like he was scared shitless. He was
did he say not?
It's entertainment.
Hitler wouldn't even use chemicals, or Hitler wouldn't even use gas.
Hey,
Alex, I live an hour from Dow Chemical. They made the napalm that we dropped in Vietnam, which was after World War II.
No, but wait a minute. I'm asking you this question, though. What was the statement exactly? Did it reference gas or chemicals?
I'm not sure.
Because if it referenced
and I watched it live, it doesn't make any difference.
But no, it does make a difference, because if he said Hitler never used gas, I'm sorry, you're wrong.
I think he did say gas, because that was the
different kind of gas.
Yeah. 6 million people died from the gassing of Adolf Hitler. Okay?
Yep.
What planet are these?
No. Don't ask that question. Okay, here's the question you've got to ask. Who are the people that voted for these ninnies?
Exactly.
You know,
did these people ever go to school?
Yeah, well, I don't know. You know, I've been living, you know, lately I was getting very depressed because I was beginning to come to terms with my own mortality, you know. And Jeff, please don't laugh at me, because you've been through this. You know, a couple of times, and so you probably know how to deal with it. But it's no fun when they tell you that. Well, you know, it doesn't matter if you get prostate cancer, because you'll probably outlive it. You only have a life expectancy of 10 to 15 years, and you go, what?
Yeah.
You know, I remember when I used to have my whole life in front of me. You know, and. I don't know. I want to be around for that first rocket to Mars. You know, I want to do a lot of things. But the one thing that I think about is I really don't have to worry about this administration, because no matter how much they fuck up the country, with my 15-year life expectancy at the high end, I'm not going to live to see the repercussions. You know, unless, for instance, you know, Korea decides to turn New York City into an ash heap, you know, with a missile or something.
Yeah, that's another one.
Well, first of all, do you really think his nuclear weapons work?
I don't know, but I'm on the West Coast. That makes me nervous anyway.
I mean,
why not?
You know, I'm going to.
You know, it's not that hard to make a nuclear bomb.
It really isn't. You just got to smash two things together, right?
Well, it's more sophisticated than that, but...
But that's essentially it.
You know, France can do it any time, so...
The White House can't even plan an Easter egg roll for next week. They're not going to have it done in time. They can't even plan that.
No.
Wait a minute. Haven't they had an Easter egg roll every year?
Yep.
And isn't there somebody at the White House who is president... independent, in other words, somebody who's just there, who's in charge of events like the Easter egg roll and so on.
Coordinator.
Yeah, coordinator. Yes, yeah. Does he really have to? Why can't they do it? You get a couple of eggs. You get a couple.
Manages everything.
You get a couple of eggs. You get a couple of kids, and you roll on the.
I know why he won't do, because the kids will probably throw eggs at him.
No, he wants to go to Mar-a-Lago this weekend, and it ruins his weekend to stay at the White House.
He needs to get that trip in.
So there's really not going to be.
That couldn't even throw out the ball at the opening baseball game, because people would have booed him there.
Yep.
Wow.
I guarantee you, he will not pardon that turkey this year.
Well, listen, I'll tell you something. I wouldn't do it either. That is the stupidest thing. You know, that is the stupidest thing.
It is.
Oh, we're going to pardon a turkey. Oh, you can't. Some guy's about to be executed on a death row somewhere. You can't pardon him so you don't kill a human being. No, we're going to save the turkey.
Well, then on that note, he will pardon the turkey.
That's right. Anthony.
Are we talking about Spicer again?
Doesn't matter.
And they have a replacement for Spicer already. They put out some feelers. They're thinking about Dennis Miller.
No.
His best stand-up job ever.
Yeah. Anthony, is there any way you can get a little more light on yourself? Because we'd love to see you better.
Yeah, let me move over to someplace that's a little more light.
There you go. There we are. What are you using? A laptop, right?
Yeah.
So you can move that around the room. Oh, yeah. Now we see you. Handsome looking guy, isn't he, ladies and gentlemen?
Older than I thought, too.
Yeah. What do you think about all of this? The Spicer give you pause?
Well, Spicer's the best. About a 45-minute gig he does of stand-up a day. It's not too bad. I mean, if you expect to hear something stupid, I mean, you tune in.
Is it my imagination, or do the networks run his press conferences every day?
Definitely CNN's been covering it. But the thing that is amazing to me is he puts in this, these little tidbits of his observations. Like, he always sits there and says, I find it interesting that you won't cover this, but you'll cover this. Well, I don't think that anybody's really coming there for, Spicy's observations of, what he finds. I don't know whether he's doing bad Seinfeld or he just he's just the worst shill I've ever seen in my life. And I mean, the worst.
Yeah.
He's practicing to be a pundit on Fox after he retires. That's what he's doing.
Here's what I wonder. If I were doing that job and everybody was saying what people are saying about him, I'd want to get out of that job because I'd be tired of being portrayed as an idiot.
Well, I have a young son.
It didn't work on W.
I have a young son, and he did give him the best compliment because he does think he looks like SpongeBob. So there's some redeeming value to him there.
He looks like SpongeBob. Great. Oh man, it's just ridiculous. Did anybody see Alec Baldwin playing Bill O'Reilly the other night?
Yes. Yeah.
Now I'm getting tired of Baldwin's Trump. It's just it's just.
Yeah, he knows it too.
Yeah, but his Bill O'Reilly, my God, he was great.
Yeah, it was.
I didn't say that.
Yeah, it was amazing. Yeah, it was Bill O'Reilly, and then they had him on interviewing Trump, so it was like Baldwin with Baldwin, and I thought it was very funny.
Was that on Saturday Night Live?
Yeah. Oh. So
Alex, did you see Louis C.K.'s stand up about white privilege at the beginning?
No, I didn't. I haven't watched the whole show.
Oh, that was hilarious.
You can show he's had 32 years in stand up, and he said. And he's had four good ones. But he is really a well-honed comedian.
Louis, listen, I used to know Louis years ago. He did my show. In fact, every now and then we play a stand-up thing he did on my show. And Louis was always great. He was always terrific. I said Dave Chappelle. Chappelle was great back then. It's not like they weren't good before. It's just that somewhere America got to know them. They got it. Usually it's if you get yourself a TV series and then that becomes a platform for your career. In the case of Louis C.K., it was his Louis show. And in the case of Chappelle, it was the Chappelle show. And then he got famous for turning down, what was it? How many millions of dollars? $100 million or something like that in a contract. And Chappelle's made a marvelous comeback. But anyway, I mean, I just think that, I truly believe we're in trouble. But there was a slight little twinge I had today where I said Trump might actually be good. No. And it's not the area you would think he'd be good in. But
that too will pass.
Well, his foreign policy, where with regards now, he has now thrown the Russians under the bus.
No, he hasn't. It's all theater, Alex. It's all theater.
Yeah, but nevertheless, he has condemned them, which is something nobody thought he would do.
That's true, yeah.
You know?
So maybe they'll give us the dirt on him now.
On who?
On Trump.
Oh, yeah, maybe they'll unload the stuff they had on him. Exactly.
Yeah, right, right.
They're trying to cover up the Trump-Russia connection. Did you hear about Carter Page today?
No.
They got proof that in July they got a FISA warrant. In order to get that, you would actually have to have probable cause that he was acting as an agent of a foreign country, since he's a U.S. citizen. That's how deep this investigation's going now. So, not that he's, but he was trying to negotiate all kinds of things with the, and Carter Page has admitted it already.
Really?
He confirmed it. Now, who knows how much is involved, but that's why Comey wanted to make a statement before the election, that there was a lot of crap going on.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I guess, you know, it's not good. It's not good. So anyway, you know me, I'm a hypochondriac.
You know.
Would you agree, Jeff? Yes, Jeff is more absolutely. Than in you know. And in a way it's selfish of me to be a hypochondriac. You know, when I'm a hypochondriac, every now and then you come to mind, Jeff, and I say, you know, here's a guy who's had problems, big problems, and yet he keeps moving forward, you know, and he's got a smile on his face whenever we talk to him, and yet I'm sitting around worrying about imaginary diseases. How selfish is that, you know? Oh, here comes Brian. Oh, good. Wait a minute. Brian's not there now. Where is he?
You say you worry about these diseases, but I followed you in the Guggenheim today, and you were behind a young woman. And I don't know. I don't know how sick you might be.
Yeah, wait a minute. Let me hang up on Brian, and then let me go put Brian in here. Can I put Brian in here? Let me see here. Let me add him to the group. See if he picks up. Not happening. Brian, call me again. Call failed. Okay. Hold on a second. Let me see if I got Brian here. Let me try calling him again.
You know, Alex, I got to drop off in a couple of seconds here anyway, so
yeah,
maybe you'll have room for Brian.
Well, it isn't even a question of room for Brian. We have room. In fact, I see Patrick's coming online now. But we really enjoy having you on, Anthony. You're terrific.
Oh, thanks.
You really are. Please keep calling.
All right. Well, hey, go back to the Guggenheim. It looked like, other than the bad tattoos, it looked like a good time.
I went to the Guggenheim today, and I went live from the Guggenheim. I've never been in the Guggenheim, and all the time I've lived in New York. I've been down Fifth Avenue many, many times, and there's the Guggenheim. And I figured that's all the art I want to see, the art of Frank Lloyd Wright, you know? So today I had a doctor's appointment, and when I was through, it was a matter of going to, hello there, Patrick, hello. It was a matter of just saying, well, there's the Guggenheim, and I'm walking by it, and if I'm walking by it, it's just as easy to walk into it. So I walked into it, and I paid my $18 for a senior pass to get in. Hello, Patrick. I went into the Guggenheim and walked all the way to the top, you know. But now that I weigh less, I can do things like that, you know, and not feel winded or anything else. And I went all the way to the top, it's circular, the main atrium, because I suddenly realized...
Yeah, that's a cool-looking building.
Yeah, there are rooms off to the side. You know, not just everything's not in that circle, but they do put all the paintings on the walls all the way up. And so you're passing by, you know, Degas's and Monet's and everybody else. Anyway, really, really terrific. Hello, Brian, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so I went into the, and I decided to then broadcast live. Well, now at one point, I'm at the very top, and there's this woman, and not an unattractive woman, who is short-sleeved and has the ugliest tattoos I've ever seen on her. You know how some people just, they get one tattoo and then they get another tattoo, but they don't have a coordinate with the tattoo they got, so there's no symmetry to the tattoos. And now you've got a Popeye here and a heart over here and whatever over here. Well, she was one of those. And I just said, should a person with bad tattoos be allowed into an art museum?
Absolutely. That was the observation of the day.
Yeah.
Hey, appreciate it. I'll talk to you guys later.
Okay. Call us again, Anthony. We love having you on. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Anthony, we just discovered him the other night. He called the program when we did our Sunday night program. Yes, Jeff?
When I go to the Guggenheim, I take the elevator all the way to the top and then walk out.
Wait a minute. Hold on a second. I've done something wrong here. Oh, boy. I got it. There we go. And there we go. Okay. Now we're all okay. I've had to move my pictures back around. There we go. What were you going to say? What did you say, Jeff?
I said, when I go to the Guggenheim, instead of walking up the big corkscrew,
yeah,
I take the elevator to the top and I corkscrew down.
Well, it's an easy walk down. It's not a hard walk up either. I don't know. Somehow he made the angle or whatever of a sort that you really don't feel like you're climbing.
No, it's very well designed.
You know? And I decided to walk it because I just come from my doctor. And I figured this would be a good test of my newfound health or whatever. So I did it. And then, you ready for this? I walked all the way home, which was 30 blocks through Central Park.
Oh.
And then I, all night long, my legs have been cramping. So, it was good. It was good.
It's a beautiful weather day.
It was a gorgeous day today. But anyway, I guess I should tell you what happened to the doctor, right?
Yep.
Nah.
Probably.
I have 3 weeks to live, okay?
It's good to know. You got 3 weeks left.
Well, if it goes to four, I will have felt I was living on borrowed time, right?
They just told you that so you feel better when you keep living.
No, actually.
Except if you were miserable, then.
Well, I was really worried about this thing because my PSA had jumped like a point. So I went to this urologist, and he's just a great urologist. You know, he answers all your questions, and he's easy on you, and so on. He said, don't worry about it. He said, it could have gone up for any number of reasons. He said, we could take it 6 months from now, and it could go down, or it could go up a little, or it could do a lot of different things, but it has nothing to do necessarily with you having a prostate cancer. And even if you have it, from what I can see, it's so minimal. It would be so minimal that you could live to be 90 and not have it be a problem. And I said, what if I want to live to be 91? And he didn't smile. He didn't laugh at that. He said, well, go for 90.
My doctors have a great sense.
If you want to,
go
91. Anyway, so he just said he did a thing on me. He does sonograms, as opposed to sticking a finger up your ass. And he looks at all your vitals and so on. He said, in 6 months, he said, go get another blood test. Let's take a look at that. He says, if it's gone up a little bit, if there's anything suspicious there, we'll then do a rectal sonogram. In other words, they shove the probe up your ass. But it says it's no more just uncomfortable than a finger, okay? And we'll take a picture of it and see if there's any lumps or anything like that in it. He said, but so far as I don't expect any surprises. He says, you're fine. You're in good shape. And so the week of absolute gut-wrenching worry that I went through was for nothing. And why don't I learn that as a lesson? Because you know damn well that when I'm coming close to October and I'm supposed to go get the blood test and go see the doctor again, I'm going to start stressing over it.
Well, yeah, I don't know. Maybe that you just like to worry. Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I mean, Jeff, what's wrong with me?
I don't know.
Come on, be my shrink.
I'm an engineer. I'm not a psychologist. So I think that's what your problem is.
But if I knew you, if we lived next door to each other, I would ask your opinion on this. What's wrong with me? What is it about me? It goes back to that whole thing that I got from, what's his name, from swimming to Cambodia. What's the name of that guy again? Spalding Gray. Who said to me, the reason you worry about things like this is you're a control freak. And you want to control every situation. So if you think of the worst possible outcome, and then the worst possible outcome happens, you won't be surprised.
Yeah.
I've never had the worst possible outcome happen, but I adjust for every possibility.
Yeah. I mean, I'm very much a control freak on a lot of things. But I used to travel a lot for business.
Yeah.
And I just thought about, you know, getting on an airplane and all of that. People would get nervous and say, are you going to have a good flight? And call me when you get there and all of that kind of stuff. And I said, you know what? I'm not going to control this at all. No matter what's going to happen in the airplane, it's not up to me. And no matter what I do, I'm not going to change it anyway.
So why don't
I just read the book or listen to the video or whatever they got and take it easy.
Well, there are a lot of things I can't control. Nobody can control. I can't control when I'm going to die. Okay, you know.
Well, you could if you wanted to.
Well, I can't control it. It's going to happen. I mean, I may be able to do things to stave it off, but my eventual death, there's nothing I'm going to be able to do to stop it. And I also, I can't stop certain events from happening. Like if I worry that an airplane is going to take off too late or not take off at all because of bad weather or whatever, and I'm worrying about whether I'm going to be able to get to Cincinnati or not, I have no control over that. So why should I worry about it? But I would.
You're a pessimistic optimist. Basically,
a pessimistic optimist.
You prepare for the worst, and that way, if the worst happens, you were right.
Well,
that's
exactly what I'm saying.
If the worst doesn't happen, you're happy because it didn't happen.
If the
can't lose.
Well, like for instance, I walked out of the doctor's office today, and I went yippee. You know, so maybe at least for the pure momentary joy I got out of going to the doctor and having him say, "Don't worry about it." Maybe it was worth all the grief I gave myself because otherwise I wouldn't be that happy.
You need to be an opportunistic pessimist.
Opportunistic.
That means accept the fact it's going to be bad news 6 months from now and live your life like you only have 6 months to live.
Well, what he said to me, I said, why do you want me to take the blood test? And he said, well, primarily, among other things, for your own state of mind. That if you take the test and the blood thing is down, then you're going to feel good about that. And if it's up a little bit, then we'll stick a probe up your ass and take a look, and we'll find out that you probably haven't got anything anyway. And then, you know, this is all for your own peace of mind more than anything else. You know, so that's why I like this guy. Yeah, the only thing is he only takes checks. So,
wow.
He doesn't take credit cards. Like, if there's an overcharge or something my insurance won't pay, I got to write him a check.
Yeah. Got a couple like that, too.
Yeah. And you know something? I don't know how to write a fucking check.
You forget. Ever noticed that?
No, let me explain to you. I have a business manager. And when there's a check to be written, he writes the checks. He's been doing that for the last 25 years of my life. So I've never had to write a check. So now this guy, you know, will only take a check, and I can't call my business manager for $43.72 to write a goddamn check and send it to this guy. So I decide I will send the check myself, okay? So I first I have to go find the checks. They're somewhere in the house. And then I found them from a bank I used to use called Fleet Bank, but I didn't find them from Bank of America. And finally, I found the ones from Bank of America. And now I'm there, and it's check number 101, right? And I've had this account in Bank of America for 10 years now, right? And I have to ask girlfriend, how do I fill this thing out again? I forget.
I had a little something like that. I got tripped up a little because I hardly write checks anymore. I have one a month now. I have to do that for my the property management fee because I'm in a condominium. And I looked at it for a second. I said, wait a minute. Oh, yeah, that's how. Because I just hardly do it anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have the same thing. My wife normally sends out the checks and things like that. And I figured I had to write something recently. And I went, oh, let me see now. How do you go through this thing? Because if you don't do it frequently, you forgot about it.
Yeah. So, I mean,
kind of an old way. I mean, I use credit cards for everything.
She says, you put the date there. Then what do I put on this line? You write out the amount of money, you know, $3 and 57/XX, you know, and then you write, you know, I mean, but I had forgotten how to write a check. And then the reason I'm asking Jeff is because Jeff is in my ballpark age wise.
We're both in the 70s.
We're both in our 70s, but he's the kid between us. Okay.
Don't let him get off of that at all.
Did you, and I don't know, maybe the stroke that you had caused the problem, but have you found that you can't write well anymore? To me, it's just a chicken scratching that I...
Well...
Mine's gone worse. I mean, I have the eye problem, but it's just, you know... But mine just isn't... Because I just don't write as much, so... mine's like...
But I'm asked to sign my name, it's just... You know, before,
so goofy.
When I was younger, you could read B E N N E T T S C H. Now it's
Does it look like Trump's signature?
Trump has a fairly decent signature, doesn't he?
No, it's like a heartbeat. When he does those exec orders, it looks like a bunch of.
Oh yeah, but it's in a
lines up and down.
No, you know it
looks
what it
like
is?
An EKG.
It's it's an affected handwriting. I bet he practiced that for years to get that kind of handwriting. You know,
my mother, oh my God, her handwriting was, you know, people used to, you know, used to do better handwriting. My mother's handwriting was like textbook where they would teach when they used to teach cursive or script writing, you know?
Yeah.
My God. I could read it. I have trouble with it.
I knew a guy once who was a program director at a station in San Francisco, and he wrote me a note once. His penmanship was so great. I mean, he was like, it was calligraphy is what it was. You know, and I went, God, I wish I could write like that.
It's almost like you want to save the note.
Yeah. Oh, I did. I mean, it's just perfect. I said to him once, I said, your handwriting is just amazing. He says, yeah, I studied calligraphy. And, you know, that's the study of a Roman emperor. Calligraphy. Get it? Yes, Jeff.
Well, I learned how to do drafting in high school.
Yeah.
And part of the thing about drafting is you had to write a description of what it's about or what diameters it is and what materials it was and things like that. And those letters had to be perfect like anything else. And so in writing words, I could do that incredibly well because I was trained to do it, I guess.
Yeah, I used to look at a lot of P&IDs and blueprints and things, and it was always really nice writing. I go, dang, it's almost like it was typed.
Yeah, well, it could be too, because there was little templates that you could draw with, okay, and you know, to learn it, you know, you could do it almost perfect by that method. Yeah. But I knew how to do it.
Just you could tell different styles, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But my regular drawing, like of my name or something, it you know, it starts JS and then it kind of scrabbles right after that. Yeah. Who cares? You know? So, and like you say, when you pay something with your credit card, you don't have to do that anymore.
Yeah, well, this guy won't take credit cards. And I don't know why. I guess maybe because it costs him like 2 cents or something for every one or something.
2%.
2%, is it?
Something like that. 1%. Or 1.5%, 2%, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, listen, you know, today, I'll tell you, today I found out that, you know, the doctor said, come back in 6 months, take your blood and come in and we'll, you know, maybe stick a probe up your ass or something like that just to make sure everything's okay.
Alex, did you hear on the news today they were talking about PSA tests?
No, what did they say this time?
Yeah, I did. I did. Yeah.
They basically said that a man of over 70 should not even get one, which you told us last week.
Yeah, yeah, that's been the prevailing philosophy on in the minds of a lot of people. PSA test, in case people don't know, is a prostate-specific antigen test. And what it is that your prostate gives out with this, I don't know, liquid or whatever it puts out with, but it puts out what they call prostate-specific antigen. And what it does is it measures it, and if you've got prostate cancer, it could be real high, like a 10, or I think Phil says his is around a 10. There are people who have 30s, you know. But anything under a 4 is fine. Well, it's been a prevailing attitude. But the problem is that they found that with older people, especially men over 75, it's not women over 75. I'm not being a sexist. Women, you don't have a prostate, so fuck off. To begin with, if you get it at that point, it's probably slow growing, especially if your number isn't gigantically high. And even if you have it, they say that most guys, when they die and they do an autopsy, they find a little cancer in their prostate. It's just almost a normal part of life, but it never gets to the point where it's going to hurt you or kill you. So that if they give you a test like that, it really is just more stuff for you to worry about, you know. And so that was out today. They came out with another report on that.
Yep.
Son of a bitch. Yeah. Everybody keeps saying PSA is bullshit. My doctor says, you got to, it's something you have to take into account, but you don't use it as your only thing. And the thing I liked about him, he said, you know, a lot of doctors, you see a prostate a PSA go up, and immediately they go for a biopsy. They do a biopsy. And he says, I don't do biopsies unless I absolutely.
That's what they were saying, Alex. They were saying that because the PSA test is so unreliable that they were getting too many
unreliable
diagnoses and too much stuff they didn't need to do.
Well, a lot of the biopsies come back and no, there is no cancer. And a lot of times the biopsies come back with no cancer and the person does have cancer. Because all they're doing is sticking some needles in there randomly, and you may have missed the, you know. So I'm not biopsy crazy. You know, I'm very conservative that way. I don't want to put you through that if there's no need for it, you know. So find yourself a doctor who says that. Hey, Patrick, you've been quiet.
He hasn't had a finger up his ass lately.
He's very quiet. I can hardly hear
him. I'm going to be quiet. I'm starting to like get really sleepy, so I'm going to listen to the rest. Hopefully, I'll stay awake.
So. Okay, Steve. So you're going to leave us, is what you're saying?
Yeah, I got to. Okay. Or I'll do either that, or I'll be asleep on the phone. I think so.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's let you go then, and not be asleep on the phone. Thank you, Steve.
Yeah, all right.
Get better. Get better. So,
as
another person who has a, I don't want to call it an ailment, a condition. Could I call it a condition, Patrick, that you have?
Fine.
Huh?
Yep, fine.
Okay.
I don't care.
I'm going to jump. I'll listen, but thanks.
Okay, everybody. Okay, bye. I know you said that. Let me, here, I'll get rid of you so you don't have to. Anyway, again, am I, by being a hypochondriac, is it a kind of a selfish, self-indulgent act?
I don't think so. Everybody's different. I mean, you know, I mean, for instance, last Friday I took myself out for dinner to celebrate being paralyzed 14 years.
Yeah. You do that every year. He has a little personal party, would you say? Do you invite people at all?
No. I don't allow anyone to be with me. It's my time to reflect. It's my time to enjoy. And I also incentivize the staff to let me drag the meal out as long as I'd like. Mm-hmm. And they get a nice handsome tip then.
Yeah.
So, no, I mean, you know, when I got paralyzed, I realized that everybody's different and everybody deals with things differently. And it gave me, I became more circumspect to other people's issues. And, you know, somebody's a hypochondriac. And that's, I mean, short of getting some sort of therapy to help somebody through that, if it's not damaging, mm-hmm. so what? You know, I mean, it might drive somebody nuts that you live with, like Marjorie might get tired of hearing about it.
Oh, Marjorie would like to take a gun and shoot me sometimes. I mean, she has to put up with this, and she really shouldn't have to, you know? But I am, and it gets worse as I get older, because lately, you know, the
hype on my computer.
Huh?
I'm gonna cut off now and then sign back on my computer.
Great, because we'd love to see you, Brian. Okay, I'll help you go away. Let me see here. What do I do here? Here we go.
It just went off.
Yeah, there. I got rid of him so we could clear the screens and. See, I'm just broadcasting the screen because I can, you know. I decided that why just show me talking when I can actually show the citizen panel. But anyway, what I was going to say is that I just you know, somehow think it's a selfish act on my part, but that doesn't mean I can stop it. I always have been a hypochondriac. I always will be a hypochondriac. But it'd be nice if I could modify it, you know. And maybe I should take an one of these like Zoloft, go back on Zoloft again, because when I was on that, I lost my hypochondria. You know,
I have a friend who's a psychologist, mm-hmm. and she used to teach people to stop smoking and other type of things
yeah.
that they would take a lot of. You know, physical and mental capabilities and effort. And she used to have a couple of courses that she used to teach for people to, they were afraid to be on the airplane or whatever kind of specific things. And I remember she told me smoking was one of the things that she was pretty successful with that. And you might want to consider that. If
what do you mean, hypnosis?
Yeah, it was a hypnosis.
Well, I don't know. I think something like a Zoloft or whatever would probably do me better than that. I just don't know. I don't know if I believe that much in hypnosis. To begin with, I think I would have a hard time with this hypnosis because I think I would fight it. You know, I think you have to believe it. You know, it's interesting. There was a guy, Harrison Salisbury, was a writer for the New York Times, and he went to China to cover China years and years ago. And he came down with appendicitis. And they rushed him to the hospital, and they said, we're going to give you acupuncture as an mm-hmm. anesthetic. And he said, oh, well, I don't know if that's going to work. And they said, don't worry about it. And they gave him the acupuncture, and they started cutting into him, and he screamed bloody murder. So they had to go out. I don't know where they found something to put him out with, but they did, and they finished the operation. Afterwards, he said, I thought this acupuncture stuff was supposed to work. I mean, how many millions of Chinese people use it every year? And they said, a lot of the feeling is that Westerners don't respond to it because they don't believe in it. Mm-hmm. That there's something about the belief in something that helps it along. In the case of hypnosis, I think that's the case. I think, for instance, if we got somebody in to hypnotize Patrick, he could never be hypnotized. I just don't think Patrick could be hypnotized. Were you ever hypnotized, Jeff? Did you try it?
I don't think so.
You never, yeah. Anybody else here been hypnotized? Yeah. So I you know, and I'm sorry. If I'm going to China, I want the gas. Acupuncture, good. I'm glad you believe in it. You use it. Give me something to kill the pain.
There's some people who do it for going to the dentist.
Really?
Yeah.
Where do they put the pins? In your gums?
I'm talking about this just by medication. I mean, not medication, but intellectual response,
but,
I guess.
Yeah, I love this holistic shit, you know, but I don't want to be a part of it. I'm sorry. I just don't believe that I'm going to cure cancer with an herb. All right? You know, I don't think that I'm going to help your heart by a bunch of herbs. You can probably help your body as part of that, you know. But I don't herbs, forget it. Holistic, forget it. Just it, what is that? What is that?
You got a vacuum cleaner.
Wait a minute. Brian.
Brian.
What is that noise, Brian?
Yes.
What is that noise?
That was the printer. It just went on. I guess it was printing something. Oh, I turned off.
Yeah, maybe it was making a, it sounded like you had been attacked by drones. yeah.
Are we not?
Hey, Alex, I got something you could try.
What, Tim? Something I could try? What?
There's something you could try for your worry not. It worked for me to a certain extent. Make a video to your future self and explain why you wasted 6 months or a year worrying about something that hasn't happened yet and wasted all that time, and then make a plan to say, I'll worry about it when it comes. I'll have plenty of time then. Why? And then just live your life.
Here's the funny part. The things I worry about aren't realistic, okay? They're just pie in the sky. Hey, I might have cancer. Hey, I might get a heart attack. Hey, from my cholesterol being bad or whatever. Hey, this, hey, that. But I don't think about the real possibilities every time I take a subway that somebody might bomb it.
Right, right.
That I don't care about, you know?
They have a touch of truth to them, but if you try to think of yourself in the future and what you'll feel like if you do worry the whole time, maybe you can talk yourself out of it as possible.
Yeah, by the way, Brian has joined us. We see his picture, and he's finally not yellow anymore. Oh, now you're perfect, Brian.
White balance, I guess.
Yeah, your white balance finally started to kick in. But it's funny that people say, well, how can you live in New York when you know that there's ISIS out there and maybe they'll bomb the subway? And I go, hey, if it happens, it happens. When we had an earthquake in San Francisco, my girlfriend's going crazy. Oh, what are we going to do? Oh, no. I said, let's go over to Marin County. Oh, no, we have to go across the bridge and the earthquake might hit. And I'm calm as a cucumber. In the middle of all this buildings falling down and places on fire and all of that. And on the way out of the marina, I stopped for a few minutes to see if I could help. And she said, get in the car, let's go. And I'm going, just calm down. You know, the worst has happened already. And then all of a sudden, the ground shook again. You know, oh, get out. And under normal conditions, she was the brave one of the two of us. I never could quite figure that out. In very bad situations, I'm calm. Go figure.
When
I don't think you're afraid of dying. I think you're afraid of pain and having to go through treatment.
I think that's chemo. I think that's it. Yeah. Yeah.
But don't decide not to go through it. Just decide not to have any treatment, and then you don't have to.
But then you're going to have to go through all this pain. So you may as well try and do something about that and stay, and head it off at the pass.
Yeah, but now here's the callback of the night. Then you tell him it's a 9. The paint is good, Alex. Tell him it's a 9 or 10.
Well, if I go, I want to go in a way that, you know, I get really good drugs. You know, that would be nice.
That'd be it's a compelling case also for assisted suicide.
Well, I mean,
die anyway, then.
I'm for doctor assisted suicide. In fact, I've gone to several doctors who would be very good at it. What was it? There's a place called Kaiser, which Phil goes to.
Well, it's a Phil Frey day.
That's what I'm worried for him. My father died at Kaiser. And
it's the cheapest place to go.
Well, it's not the cheapest place to go anymore. It's an HMO now for the most part. It used to be a very good operation. It was started by Henry J. Kaiser, the aluminum magnate, although magnets don't work on aluminum, so I don't know how he was an aluminum magnate. But he had a company, and he wanted to give medical coverage to all his people, so he created built his own hospital for it. And then one thing led to another, and he said, "Oh well, I'll let unions come in here too and use it," and finally became a very big. It was really the first real case of socialized medicine in America, and it was very good. Well, over the years, it got worse and worse and worse, and I remember Larry Bubbles Brown, who does this show once a week, was my traffic guy on my radio show. And he had a spot he had to do for Kaiser. And it went, blah, 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 come see Kaiser. Kaiser's the good hospital or whatever. And then he finishes off the ad by saying, "Yes, Kaiser, doctor-assisted suicide." Canceled. Canceled. Faster than the Bill O'Reilly advertiser. Canceled.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
He lost that gig.
Yeah. No,
Bill's
but
been on vacation.
Has he?
Yes.
To try and avoid all the noise?
Probably.
Yeah.
Reflecting. Yeah. He can't deflect, so yeah.
Now, what are some of the things against him? Did he actually make passes at women and say stuff to women? And
it's been documented, apparently.
Yeah, documented enough that they paid off, what, 7 of them or something like that?
Yeah,
that sounds about right.
And it's interesting that Trump would defend him, because Trump, of course, as we know, is also a serial groper.
Interesting, but not surprising.
Yeah.
To me, at least.
Well, he can empathize with Bill.
Oh, yeah. He just can't empathize with everyone else.
Yeah. But O'Reilly lost, what was it, 30 sponsors or 50?
Yeah, 44, last I heard.
44?
No, I thought it was up in the 60s already.
You know who he lost?
It could be. Last I heard, it was 44.
You know who he lost? And this is the amazing one. Because I would say if anybody voted for Trump, it was this guy. Okay? If anybody was a right-winger, it would be this guy. If anyone would defend Bill O'Reilly because of his right-wing attitudes, it would be this guy. But I guess he isn't right-wing at all. But you've ever seen the guy who holds the pillow to his chest and says, "I invented my pillow."
Yeah.
And he wears a cross around his neck and everything. I figured this guy is Mr. Conservative, right? He was one of the first people to say, "Fuck you, I'm getting off the O'Reilly factor." In fact, I'm getting off of Fox altogether. You know, because some of these other advertisers simply switch their advertising to other places on Fox, so Fox didn't lose money. But, you know, I mean, if all these that many advertisers left him, there's a lot of stuff that's a lot of money they're not making over at Fox, because, you know, how much of that money can you spread around? But
I just put an article on Facebook.
Yeah.
That he might not come back to. That's what they're guessing.
Really?
Because the problem was with Roger Ailes, they made a commitment that there would be a zero tolerance policy. And they secretly renegotiated Bill O'Reilly's contract right before this Gloria Allred stuff started.
Yeah.
And but it does have in it, they can terminate his contract if he gets in any more trouble, if anything else comes out. So it's a real gray area.
Let me ask you this. Are all these incidences that happen prior to the Ailes thing
Or,
I don't think it matters whether it's prior. I think it's when the information comes out that's part of the contract.
I'd say that's a bit on the unfair side. But yes, Patrick.
Because he was supposed to tell him if anything else was going to come out.
Oh, I see.
So he'd actually be lying when he signed the contract. That would make the contract null and void.
Patrick.
Riley's on right now. I just slipped through, and so he's not on vacation. He may have been last week.
Oh, no, he's going on vacation there or something. They I heard it on Lawrence, and it's here on Yahoo, so he's taking off.
Well, I'm sure a lot of full-time anchor people are going to be taking vacation because of Easter week on all the networks. I don't think it's him. I don't necessarily think it would be him in particular. I bet you could go down the dial to CNN, MSNBC, NBC, ABC, and all of them.
But if you were
the main host, would be going on vacation.
If you were Bill O'Reilly, do you think you would take a vacation at this point because of the speculation that would happen?
He's got to write his new book, The Killing of Bill O'Reilly. But you know, did anybody see the video with Gloria Allred and the new accuser? They called HR and filed a complaint and taped it all. It's been on most of the news.
Well, what I thought was terrific about Gloria Allred is it looks like she's gotten herself a new facelift.
Yeah, she looks young. Maybe it's the lenses.
She looks as young as her daughter now, you know. I think she had some work done. But the trouble with Gloria Allred, and I do have respect for Allred. I mean, she really has gone out after a lot of these cases, but she's kind of an ambulance chaser with it.
That's right.
That's
what she is.
Sometimes you need them.
But no, but in some cases, I mean, she has made a career out of going after sexual harassment cases. So I have to give her credit for that specialty, okay? But it just seems many times like she's an ambulance chaser. Yes, Patrick?
She's like Al Sharpton. I mean, it's not necessarily always wrong when Al Sharpton shows up at some racial thing, but if somebody says something racist, that asshole is there.
What you're saying, it's not that he's there, it's why he's there.
Right. The thing is with him is if he's like a moth to a flame, and so is she. That I mean, if she hears sex and that's it, she's there. She didn't even have to hear the UL harassment aspect of it. You know, she gets a whore for that, and same as Al Sharpton and Jesse Jackson. I mean, they're all fucking assholes that are all they are money grubbers, and they're whores for the spotlight. And
I want to see. I want to see her up against Judge Jeanine.
Jeanine Pirro? Well, what a can I? I'll say this: a real cunt.
That's what I mean. But her against Horvath, it'd be a good fight.
Yeah. By the way,
that's
I'm not
even worse.
I'm not being sexist there because I also call guys cunts too. So you know.
Right.
It's especially in England. It's sex independent. You guys will call other guys cunts.
So, yeah, they use that word interchangeably, like we use the word bastard and asshole.
Or son of a bitch.
Well, yeah. Team Bannon calls Kushner the girl from New York.
Who? Kushner?
I think it's Kushner. Kushner gets called, is nicknamed the girl from New York by the Team Bannon.
Well, New York girls are kind of sexy. But anyway, what are you giving me a look for, Patrick? New York girls are, you'll back me up on this, right, Jeff?
Yes.
You walk down the street here in New York City, and every block, you'll see a woman, and you'll gasp. You know.
Well, that one you were falling down the Guggenheim wasn't too bad today.
Yeah, right.
Her cheeks hanging out underneath them. All right, now we're getting nasty.
There was this woman in front of me who was wearing rather.
There are no FCC regulations, as far as I know.
What do they call that? You know. Those when they wear take jeans, cut them down really short.
Yeah, short shorts or whatever.
Yeah, well, she was very good. It's from behind. I don't know what she looked like from the front, but I didn't really care much. A lot of us are getting Schadenfreude out of this thing with Bill O'Reilly. We like seeing a guy we don't like get it. The question is, you know, he was doing this during the Roger Ailes era. Could you not say that the person at the top, his demeanor, then dictates the demeanor of others? Does that make sense?
Right over the leader. I mean, there's a term in business about that.
Yeah, I mean, we blame a lot of people in this country for their racism and so on as Trump giving them permission. The guy at the top does something, so therefore it must be okay. And could he perhaps be a victim of that? That perhaps after Ailes got into trouble, he didn't do anything because he knew he was smarter than that. And he saw how bad it was. Could very well be. But nobody, he's never given that kind of explanation. But if none of these cases were after Ailes, then I would say you kind of got to give him a little bit of leeway. Even though it's still in bad taste and it was still terrible what he did. Have any of the allegations been particularly odorous? I mean, outside of him making comments about the way somebody was dressed or...
He wanted favors, and he kept it secret. He paid enough money to keep them secret.
Making phone calls to these women.
Why would you do that? Why would you do that? I mean, I've been in a position of that kind of power, but I never once. My great big rule was, even if they're the sexiest human being on the face of the earth, do not come onto your staff.
I can answer that question for you, Alex. It's because you have integrity. Something which Mr. O'Reilly lacks.
No, it wasn't integrity. You know what it was? I had one woman who worked for me. Her name was, at that time, her name was Christy Frazier. She's been married several times, so she had several different names. I still see her every now and then to this day, think the world of her. When I first saw her, this was maybe one of the most gorgeous women I have ever seen, okay? And sexy, too. And, I never, ever made a pass at her. And she worked for me. She worked as my producer on several occasions. And I never, ever came on to her. Why? Because I valued her as a person who worked for me. She was so good at what she did. I didn't want to destroy it by some kind of careless act of self-indulgence.
Okay, and principle as well.
You know.
Respect.
Principle didn't have as much... Respect had a lot to do with it.
Yep.
But principle didn't have anything to do with it. My guiding principle here was, this is somebody who does a great job for me. I'm not going to screw up having a great person working for me because I might get into a relationship with her. And we all know how most relationships wind up. You know, the only ones that last are the ones that are for some reason still around, right? So you'd never, you don't, they say you don't put your, dip your pen in the company inkwell, and I think that's a pretty good
way. The way I've heard it was, you don't shit where you eat.
Well, that's another one too. Although sometimes I have shit where I ate, so I am sorry.
Oh, we all make mistakes.
Don't you think it's actually a disease, though? Like for Clinton and Bill O'Reilly, there's a disease factor to it too.
Okay, well, I think Clinton's slightly different. Let me put it this way. Okay, if one of these women at work. And by the way, I'm not saying that they necessarily, I wouldn't have sex with a woman that I worked at some place with, just somebody who didn't work for me.
Right, absolutely.
All right. But if somebody came on to me, you know, that's a temptation. I mean, Monica Lewinsky was a big temptation. I mean, well, you can give it a dirty look, Patrick, but, you know, as I've said so many times, I would have done her. You know.
He was a country boy. He was a country boy.
But no, here's a woman who wants to do something for you, and you're still... Also, remember that Clinton was maybe, outside of Barack Obama, the only president we've had that was, like, in his sexual prime. All right? And so, of course he would give in to that kind of temptation.
Well, don't forget Kennedy.
And I'll tell you, let me tell you something. I've said this about Kennedy, too. Let me tell you this. I mentioned this before. I interviewed Jennifer Flowers years ago. And she felt that nobody believed that Clinton had sex with her. And she said on my show, she says, you know, I really did have sex with him. And I said, I believe you. I absolutely believe you. I said, that's not the question I want to ask you. She says, what's the question you want to ask me? I said, did he treat you like a lady? Did he treat you like a decent person? Did he act like a decent person? And she said, he was the best. He said, we'd have sex one night. The next day he would call to see if I was okay and say how much he enjoyed himself, and was always, never made me feel like I was a whore. And I said, then I'll vote for him again. I said, that because isn't that the measure of somebody? Not whether they had sex with somebody, but whether they treated them with respect.
The opposite of Bill Cosby.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
That's what makes Bill Cosby so bad.
You know, and it's funny because I've gone to bed with a lot of women in my time, and especially as a result of the job that I was doing, not women who work for me, but, you know, women who were, shall we say, groupies, maybe that might be one way of putting it. And I was always very, very much the gentleman in the situation because that's the way I was raised. You know, my father said, you always respect women. So I would never force myself on a woman, but if they wanted to, hey, I'm ready for it, you know. Today, though, I could probably get in trouble for that because there would be some women who would take that as a sign that they could then turn around and extort some money or something. Because they had gone to bed with me on a particular situation, and because it's just the two of us, I can't say, hey, I was a gentleman. To begin with, who's going to believe the guy anyway?
Doesn't matter.
You know, it's very hard for a guy these days. I mean, you got to be very careful about, you know, what you do and who you sleep with and so on. Because they can come back and accuse you of all kinds of things. And because there's only two of you in the room, who are they going to believe? You know, they're going to take the woman's word before they take the guy's word. I mentioned that I had a situation happen once. That I got to get a call, and it's from some guy, and he says, I have to talk to you. I said, about what? He said, getting my daughter pregnant. I said, and I'm thinking, well, this could be any one of a number of people that I've slept with. You know, I just want to know which one now, you know. And I said, what's her name? And he gives me her name, and I said, I'd never heard of her.
Can't do that sound, did you?
Huh? What were you going to say?
Nothing.
You know, so I said, I don't know this woman that you're calling about. I don't know your daughter. She says, well, she turned up pregnant, and we asked her who got her pregnant, and she said Alex Bennett. She was accusing me because she didn't want to say who it was. And she took the first name that she could remember, and she said me. And finally, he confronted her again, and she admitted that she hadn't slept with me and didn't even know me. But there's a perfect example of how you can wind up getting in trouble for doing absolutely nothing. And because you're the guy, you're going to be the first one accused of it. I've told the story many times here about the situation I had in Lillehammer with my newswoman, Lori Thompson, and some woman accused me of hitting her. Not somebody else, not Lori. So I come in the morning, Coca-Cola was running the whole thing, and the Coca-Cola police picked me up and put me in a room all by myself and say, stay there until Lori gets in and we can find out what happened. I won't go into the whole story of how they got, there was a woman said that I had hit Lori, okay? Which, number one, I would never hit a woman. That's just beyond anything I would ever do. I would never, for the most part, ever hit a guy, okay? And so she comes in, and they said, did he hit you last night? And they went, no. Step number two, they're down there profusely apologizing to me because they were really, literally, they had kept me prisoner. Without any proof of anything on the word of this crazy woman who was her roommate in Lillehammer, who was nuts, and they finally rather than make me go home, they sent the woman home. You know, but they were ready to believe her over me. I could protest it any number of times and say I didn't do it and I wouldn't do it and it's not my style. And they just go, we have to wait till Lori gets here. We have to get the woman's side of it. We have to get her blessing. And if Lori had said, yeah, hated me and said, yeah, he hit me, I would have been in Coca-Cola jail for the rest of my life.
Yeah, even screwed.
But so I know what happens when guys are accused of stuff and how you've got to go through hell to try and prove that you're not guilty. That's why I say, see, here's the thing with Bill Cosby. My attitude is, I don't think all those women had, you know, had sex without their permission. I think that they were involved with him in some way and wanted to sleep with him, and now they can come forward. I say that, saying this as well, that if only 10% of those women are not lying, that's enough. One yeah. would be enough, okay? So I don't care about the 50, I care about the 10 who actually, you know, 10% who actually did, maybe the five women who honestly were drugged by him, passed out, and the next thing they knew, Fat Albert is fucking them, you know?
What are you doing?
Now that sounds like Scooby-Doo.
But he
somebody.
Always talked about French, what do you call it? French flies?
Oh, a Spanish fly.
Spanish.
You
French
know,
fries.
When I grew up, that was the drug du jour. They used to say, right. Oh, give the woman some Spanish fly. I never in my life have seen Spanish fly. Or yeah. even know what the hell it's supposed to be. I think it never existed. You know.
I heard about it, and it was said, well, you could get it in Mexico.
Yeah, but...
But...
I've never seen it.
That's all I know.
I've never seen it. I've never known anybody that's taken it. Yeah. You know? I mean, we came up with better stuff. Roofies, certainly. Yeah. You know? Also, Cosby, did I read something the other day that Cosby has like sheltered his money so he can't, nobody can get it away from him?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
I would.
Oh, yeah. Well, why? How old is he? How much longer is he going to live? You know, let's say he lives to be 90. He's already in what, his 80s somewhere?
Yeah.
So, I mean, and he has nothing to live for now. So, you know, I mean.
Well, maybe he likes his wife and he wants to make sure she's taken care of, I guess.
I'm sure, but how many years has she got left? She's an old
man.
Yeah,
I know. It's not that far behind.
I hear he's blind.
Yeah, he's going blind.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, it's a sad thing that it happened to him. I don't know if you saw the Dave Chappelle special, but Chappelle brings up the whole thing about Cosby, and then he takes a break from joking about Cosby and says, but to tell you the truth, this guy did a lot of good for black people. And he talks about the college funds he started and, you know, the TV shows he did that were educational and all this stuff. I mean, he spent his life doing this sort of thing.
Yeah, when I was a kid, I grew up on all them, you know, those old...
And they all had a certain educational value, and they also brought the races closer together. I mean, under normal conditions, absent all this sex stuff, Bill Cosby was a great guy.
Yeah.
You know, he did good work. And yet, you know, what Chappelle was saying was, maybe you have to weigh the good against the bad. You know, maybe these 50 rapes were worth it for us getting together and liking each other. I don't know that I agree with that assessment, but he said you have to kind of balance it all out and say, here was the good of the man. So he took time out to talk about how good he was. Patrick?
I think that's something for history kind of decide.
Yeah.
And he does make a point that you do need to look at the good he did. However, you know, the bad he did, whether it was one woman that was legitimately raped or five or more, it's a tarnish on that image. But, you know, I guess if you know, history will decide that. And maybe it'll be 20, 30, 40 years where, you know, the rapes and that will still be marked. But people will remember that he did all these things, yeah. You know.
Well, I don't think I truly don't think he's going to be remembered for anything but this. To be truthful with you, I think it is so a blight on his whole career that nobody's going to go back and say, "Hey, listen to this comedy album by Bill Cosby," because you just can't listen to it anymore without thinking this is Bill Cosby the rapist.
That's the problem, because it's happened at the end of his life, and if he's, you know, gone, that's what everybody's going to be thinking about, the last thing he did.
Yeah.
I've got Bill Cosby himself and a couple of other things that I've listened to since, you know, the rapes, and he's still the same guy on those for me.
Yeah.
I think you're right. For the younger generation, that's what's going to be remembered more so than maybe my age or you guys who remember when he was starting out, or like me growing up with him. But yeah, maybe you're right. Everybody younger in the millennials and younger, they're not going to know any of that.
That's all they know of him is the bad part.
Right. And whether they're black, white, or whatever, that's all they're going to know. So yeah, you make a good point there.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, it's you know, it is a sad thing when these things do happen. But they do happen, and figure out how this guy's going to place in history, and I think he's going to place very badly. Just like
there's a quote I heard a long time ago. The quote is: "The brighter the picture, the darker the negative."
Well, okay. The thing is that I'm thinking of is that, for instance, Richard Nixon will always be remembered as the guy who got to quit office, then was forced to leave office. You know, nobody's sitting around saying, "Hey, remember what he did here?" And he went to they do remember he went to China, but that's mentioned. But the first thing that's always mentioned is he's the guy who left office in disgrace.
Yeah.
So any other stuff, good stuff, although I can't think of any good stuff Nixon did, but any good stuff, it's like...
I can still see the headlines in the papers.
Yeah.
"I will not resign." A week later, Nixon resigns. I had him posted on my wall.
Yeah. We're here to bury Caesar, not to praise him. The good men do as often tear it with their bones, yeah. And the evil lives after them, basically. I don't remember the speech word for word, but that's essentially what it says. And in the case of most of these people, the good in Bill Cosby will be buried with him. The bad will last forever.
Yep.
You know, just like there was a guy named, what was that? Oh, boy. Fatty Arbuckle. And Fatty Arbuckle was, put on trial in San Francisco for raping a woman by the name of Virginia Rappe. Is that not great? Virginia Rappe. And but people will always remember him as the guy who raped somebody, yet by the third trial, they found him completely innocent of anything.
Yeah, I remember all that, too.
Yeah, and... and the judge, in fact, said this had been a big miscarriage of justice that he was even brought before this court, and that it took three trials, two of them a hung jury, to finally find this guy didn't do anything. He wasn't even in San Francisco. He was in L.A.
He was destroyed,
at the time.
Though.
But he was destroyed. Worked for a short time as a movie director, called himself Will Be Good, and he eventually died, as his wife said, of a broken heart. At a very young age, in his 40s. So, you know, that's why I'm always kind of a little skeptical when I hear the Cosby stories and stuff. I want to wait and see if it's all really true. Anyway, thank you so much, Scott. We really appreciate it. Kevin, thank you. Great having you here. Brian, you as well. Jeff, you. You know, you're always welcome at these microphones. Tim, thank you. Patrick, we think the world of you. Also, Steve Thomas, let's thank him. And wait a minute, what's the other guy's name? Oh, well, Scott Bodker. Anthony, I'm going to get slaughtered, this name, Zambataro. Is that close enough? I guess. Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. I really appreciate it. And we'll hopefully see you again tomorrow. Thank you. Bye-bye. Okay, that's it. That's it. Yeah, that's that's all she wrote for our little thing here we call the ramble. We'll be here back again. Hey, let me do this a little bit so I get a little more of my face in there. There we go. The hat is off at the top. We'll see you again tomorrow, same time. Well, I used to be able to do this so smoothly. Jack and Amy are next with The Intersection, followed by Connections at 1 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time. In the meantime, I'll see you tomorrow, same time, same station in life. And if you see her, you know what to do, of course. Tell her I love her, okay?